In this video, we'll go over the Fibonacci sequence and a derivation of its surprising explicit equation. This equation is known as Binet's formula, and is f of n equals 1 over square root of 5 times 1 plus square root of 5 over 2 to the n, minus 1 over square root of 5 times 1 minus square root of 5 over 2 to the n. This equation is far from simple, but we'll go through what I consider a rather natural process and discover it for ourselves. For those who are unfamiliar, the Fibonacci sequence is defined by the recursive relation f of n plus 2 equals f of n plus 1 plus f of n, and the starting conditions f of 1 equals 1 and f of 2 equals 1. In other words, we start with 1, 1, and each term after is the sum of the previous two. The first few values are 1, 1, 2, 3, 5, 8, 13, 21, and so on. Okay. Now on to the problem of finding an explicit equation for this, a function f of n that can be used to find the nth Fibonacci number without finding any other terms in the process. As the sequence is a recursion involving two previous terms, it's not obvious how to find an explicit equation, or even how to begin. So let's break it down a bit. The most restraining part of the definition is the recursion. So let's try to find any function that satisfies the recursion f of n plus 2 equals f of n plus 1 plus f of n, and ignore the requirement that the first and second terms are 1. But that's already pretty difficult. What would such a function roughly look like? Is it a polynomial, exponential, a combination, or perhaps something else entirely? To gain more intuition about functions with recursive properties like this, we solve a simpler problem. Instead of two-term recursion, what about a one-term one? Consider the recursion f of n plus 1 equals 2 times f of n. This just means each term is twice the previous, a simple geometric sequence. And so, if we have f of 0 equals c, then f of 1 is 2c, f of 2 is 4c, f of 3 is 8c, and it's becoming pretty clear that c times 2 to the n satisfies the recursion. So that's great. An exponential just might be what we're looking for. But will an exponential function still work for the Fibonacci relation f of n plus 2 equals f of n plus 1 plus f of n? I hope so, and the easiest way to find out is by trying it. So let's set f of n equal to a times b to the n and hope for the best. After using our definition of f, the Fibonacci recurrence f of n plus 2 equals f of n plus 1 plus f of n becomes a times b to the n plus 2 equals a times b to the n plus 1 plus a times b to the n. We can then divide by a on both sides to get b to the n plus 2 equal to b to the n plus 1 plus b to the n. Now that we've completely eliminated a, this implies that the value of a has no effect on whether or not the function will satisfy the Fibonacci recurrence. We can then divide by b to the n on both sides to get b squared equals b to the first plus b to the zeroth, or b squared equals b plus 1. And this is just a quadratic equation. Rearranging, we get b squared minus b minus 1 equals 0, and applying the quadratic formula, b is equal to 1 plus or minus square root of 5 over 2. So we in fact get two different possible values of b. But as a side note, before we move on, there's a small flaw in the steps above. If a or b is 0, then we'll be dividing by 0. Thankfully, this mistake isn't too hard to patch up. If a is 0, then that means f of n is equal to 0 times b to the n, which is just 0. Similarly, if b is 0, we get that f of n is 0 as well. And f of n equals 0 is indeed a solution to the recurrence. Just not one that's useful. Now going back to the main trail, we expect both f of n equals a times 1 plus square root of 5 over 2 to the n, and f of n equals a times 1 minus square root of 5 over 2 to the n, both to satisfy the Fibonacci relation. As an example, I'll show that b equals 1 plus square root of 5 over 2 works. With f of n equal to a times 1 plus square root of 5 over 2 to the n, this means that f of n plus f of n plus 1 is equal to a times 1 plus square root of 5 over 2 to the n plus a times 1 plus square root of 5 over 2 to the n plus 1. We can factor to get a times 1 plus square root of 5 over 2 to the n times 1 plus 1 plus square root of 5 over 2. Now, as it turns out, 1 plus 1 plus square root of 5 over 2 is equal to 1 plus square root of 5 over 2 squared. This is no coincidence. We specifically found this value of b because it satisfies 1 plus b equals b squared. Thus, the right-hand side becomes a times 1 plus square root of 5 over 2 to the n times 1 plus square root of 5 over 2 squared, which is a times 1 plus square root of 5 over 2 to the n plus 2, or just f of n plus 2. So we have shown that f of n equal to a times 1 plus square root of 5 over 2 to the n always satisfies f of n plus f of n plus 1 equals f of n plus 2. Similarly, f of n equals a times 1 minus square root of 5 over 2 to the n will as well. We have made lots of progress finding two functions that satisfy the recurrence f of n plus 2 equals f of n plus 1. F of n equals c1 times 1 plus square root of 5 over 2 to the n, and f of n equals c2 times 1 minus square root of 5 over 2 to the n, where c1 and c2 can be any constant we desire. So now, we turn to the other part of Fibonacci, the initial conditions f of 1 equals 1 and f of 2 equals 1. Now let's see if the first family can fit the initial conditions. Using f of 1 equals 1, we have 1 equals f of 1, which equals c1 times 1 plus square root of 5 over 2 to the first, so 1 equals c1 times 1 plus square root of 5 over 2, and thus c1 must be 1 over 1 plus square root of 5 over 2. Now dealing with the second constraint, f of 2 equals 1, we get 1 equal to f of 2, which is equal to c1 times 1 plus square root of 5 over 2 squared. We must have c1 equal 1 over 1 plus square root of 5 over 2 from before, so we substitute that in, and get the right side to be 1 plus square root of 5 over 2. Which, unfortunately, is not equal to the 1 on the left side. If we try the second family, something similar happens with it as well. So we ran into another problem. But it's not too surprising a simple exponential failed. I mean, clearly the Fibonacci sequence is not an exponential equation. We are at a bit of a roadblock again. Currently, after we choose the b value, the two initial conditions create two equations involving the one variable c. Typically, in order to solve two simultaneous equations, we need two variables we can choose, two degrees of freedom. So somehow, we need to double how many variables we have. And we can do just that. The last important insight is to realize that we can add any two functions that fit the Fibonacci relation to make another one that fits it as well. Suppose we have two functions g of n and h of n that both satisfy the Fibonacci recurrence. Then if we let f of n be their sum, g of n plus h of n, we can show that it will satisfy Fibonacci as well. We have f of n plus f of n plus 1 equal to g of n plus h of n plus g of n plus 1 plus h of n plus 1, which, rearranging, is g of n plus g of n plus 1 plus h of n plus h of n plus 1. Since both g and h fit the Fibonacci relation, the right side is just g of n plus 2 plus h of n plus 2. And using the definition of f one last time, that's just f of n plus 2. Thus, adding two functions that fit Fibonacci will create a new one that does so as well. Although it feels a bit like magic, the underlying reason why summing two solutions creates another one is because, in the recursion, the two different functions g and h act almost disconnected to one another due to the simple, linear nature of addition. They don't get into each other's way, as squaring or other operations would. This idea of summing solutions to create more is not only relevant here, but also in other branches of math, such as differential equations. Because of this, that means we can sum the two families together and get a more general family that will always work. F of n equals c1 times 1 plus square root of 5 over 2 to the n, plus c2 times 1 minus square root of 5 over 2 to the n. This gives us two variables, c1 and c2, to work with, so now we can satisfy both initial conditions. So time to plug and chug! But actually, we can simplify things a bit more still. When we plug f of 2 in, it makes a bit of a mess, so instead, I'd rather deal with f of 0, as anything to the 0 is just 1. Using the Fibonacci relation and going backward, we get f of 0 is just 0. So actually, we can replace the initial conditions f of 1 equals 1 and f of 2 equals 1 with f of 0 equals 0 and f of 1 equals 1. This still generates the exact same Fibonacci sequence as before. So now, we finally find what the constants c1 and c2 are. Using the condition f of 0 equals 0, we get that 0 is equal to f of 0 is equal to c1 times 1 plus square root of 5 over 2 to the 0, plus c2 times 1 minus square root of 5 over 2 to the 0. Anything to the 0 is just 1, so this becomes 0 is equal to c1 plus c2, or c2 is equal to negative c1. Now, using the condition f of 1 equals 1, we get that 1 is equal to f of 1 is equal to c1 times 1 plus square root of 5 over 2 plus c2 times 1 minus square root of 5 over 2. Using the substitution c2 equals negative c1, this becomes 1 is equal to c1 times 1 plus square root of 5 over 2 minus c1 times 1 minus square root of 5 over 2. This simplifies down to 1 equals c1 times square root of 5, so that means c1 is equal to 1 over square root of 5. Now c2 is equal to negative c1, which is equal to negative 1 over square root of 5. So ultimately, we get that f of n is equal to 1 over root 5 times 1 plus root 5 over 2 to the n minus 1 over root 5 times 1 minus root 5 over 2 to the n. Now if you search up Binet's formula, with perhaps a bit of rearranging, you'll get exactly the formula we found, which I think is pretty neat. So there you have it! We found an explicit equation to the seemingly purely recursive Fibonacci sequence. And before I end this video off, here's a problem for you to try. Creating a function like this was one of the parts of the USA JMO 2018, problem 1. The exact problem statement was, for each positive integer n, find the number of n-digit positive integers that satisfy both of the following conditions. No two consecutive digits are equal, and the last digit is a prime. This will eventually boil down into a function satisfying the following properties. A of n is equal to 8 a of n minus 1 plus 9 a of n minus 2, and the initial conditions a1 is equal to 4 and a2 is equal to 32. See if you can figure out the function that fits this.